I want to welcome you all to the Baker Institute. We're very pleased to have you here with us this evening. This evening is the second event in a three-part program that we started on Monday night, December 8th. We're looking at the space program back in the past and the present and the future. And I think with the state of the space program today in this country, it's probably appropriate that we take a look at where we've been and where we are and where we're going. And of course, this month, I think, is an appropriate time to do that, in that this month, on December 17th, it'll be the 100th anniversary of man's first flight in an aircraft in space at Kitty Hawk. And that'll be celebrated this month on December 17th. This month also marks the 35th anniversary of man's first flight out of Earth orbit on Apollo 8. And I'm sure you all remember that memorable Christmas Eve, those of you that were watching television at that time, when the crew read scripture while they flew around the moon. A very important and very significant evening that night. But of course, that was the past, and we are now looking this evening at the present. And I think we're very fortunate to have three individuals who can speak very eloquently about the present. We have with us this evening Brewster Shaw, Frank Culbertson, and Peggy Whitson. Brewster is an astronaut who has flown three times in space. He became an astronaut in 1978 and then flew for the first time in 1983 on the first space lab mission on board Columbia. And then he flew again in 85 and again in 89, commanding those missions. He then became a key management individual in the program and worked at the Kennedy Space Center in shuttle operations, managing the activities for shuttle operations at KSC, and then became the shuttle program manager. And after serving in that capacity for a number of years, he then moved on into industry, went with Rockwell, and was involved in their engineering activities. And then when Boeing acquired Rockwell, he became a part of Boeing and eventually ended up managing the space station program for the Boeing company, and then became the general manager of Boeing activities here in Houston. The space shuttle is operated by a company called the United Space Alliance, which is a joint venture of the Boeing company and the Lockheed Martin company. And now Brewster has moved on and is executive vice president and the chief operating officer of the United Space Alliance, which is responsible for operating the space shuttle. So he's been very much involved in our space program ever since he came to the NASA and became an astronaut. Prior to that time, of course, he served in the U.S. Air Force, had a very distinguished career in the Air Force, and flew missions in South Vietnam, both in the F-100 and the F-4, and was a test pilot when he came into the program. So I think we'll hear, I think, some good words to, tonight from Brewster, certainly about the state of the shuttle and probably about the station as well. Frank Culbertson is an astronaut as well, and Frank came into the program in 1984, and he has flown three times and commanded missions in the space shuttle. And then he, as Brewster did, moved into management, and he managed the Shuttle Mir program for NASA and was responsible for managing all those activities and the missions that we flew the shuttle up to the space station Mir, and worked very closely with his Russian colleagues in successfully accomplishing those flights. He then went back on flight status, and he was the commander of Expedition 3 that went up to the International Space Station and spent 129 days in orbit on board the space station. He, as Brewster, then decided he would go into a different field, and he's now a vice president with SAIC here in Houston. And so he's involved in industry now, supporting the space program. Peggy Whitson is still with NASA, and she's an astronaut as well. And she is a Rice graduate. She received her doctorate here at Rice. and then went to work for NASA and worked in the life science organization at NASA, and then became an astronaut in 1996. She was very much involved in a lot of the scientific work that was done on board Mir in life sciences, and then also in planning the activity for the space station, and then decided to play an active part in it herself and became an astronaut. She led NASA's support activities in Star City, leading up to the flight of the space station and supporting the Mir program. And then she now had her first flight aboard a space shuttle up to the International Space Station, and she has flown 184 days in space. And I think brings a wealth of experience to the astronaut office, and now is serving as the deputy chief of the astronaut office in Houston. So I think we're very fortunate to have these three individuals with us this evening. And as we look at the present, I think they can speak to it very well. So I'll turn it over to Brewster, who I think can talk, as I say, both about the shuttle and the station. And then Frank and Peggy will also all join in on the station. Brewster?
Plan B.
Yeah.
Thank you, George.
Pleasure to be here. I'm going to present some prepared remarks. And then I think after we each get through making our presentations, we'll have an opportunity for some dialogue where probably the more interesting things will get discussed. The space shuttle is the most capable, reliable, and versatile human-rated space transportation system in the world. As our primary transportation link to and from low Earth orbit, the shuttle has kept the United States on the cutting edge of space exploration and scientific discovery for the last two decades. No other launch vehicle, either in development or in operation today, can match the space shuttle's capabilities. Together, the space shuttle and the International Space Station represent an unequaled operational infrastructure in Earth orbit that will be central to enabling future advancements in human exploration and development of space. Combined, they provide the means for round-trip transportation for humans and materials, investigations in a variety of science and exploration disciplines, and the testing, development, and validation of theories and technologies. Most importantly, they provide us the critical means to adapt our mission and continue to advance as we learn more about ourselves and our world. Space travel is inherently risky. Everyone involved in the human exploration and development of space understands this. The assets and human lives that are risked in this endeavor underscore the value we place on the broad global benefits that it brings. Accordingly, we are obligated to continue. In the near term, to make the space shuttle system as safe as reasonably possible and return it to flight. In the long term, to incorporate the lessons we have learned into the design and operation of the next human-rated space vehicle. In the meantime, the culture of the human spaceflight industry is in the crosshairs of public opinion. As we work together to resolve the technical and engineering challenges involved in returning to flight, nothing will be more greatly scrutinized than the health and vitality of the program's organization and decision-making processes. The technical cause of the Columbia accident is clearly understood, and the space shuttle team is working diligently to eliminate it. The matter of dealing with organizational culture, however, is considerably more complex and difficult. The Columbia Accident Investigation Board has prescribed a number of new checks and balances in the human part of the system, in part to improve communications, decision-making, and accountability across the program. NASA has already begun the process of transformation and renewal, not only embracing those recommendations, but also by adding a number of initiatives of their own. NASA is demonstrating the leadership and resolve needed to return our nation to safe flight with renewed focus and sense of purpose. We will always remember the courageous crew of Columbia and their mission to improve our world. In setting about the process of returning to flight, we will again inevitably address the fundamental human spaceflight question, is it safe enough? And we will again rely on the very brightest and most dedicated people we have to make it so, and we will continue to fly. In doing so, we owe it to future crews and their families to apply the lessons of Columbia with courage and determination. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Brewster. As Brewster said, we will open it up to questions after the three speakers complete their presentations. So let me turn it over to Frank.
Thank you very much, Mr. Abbey, and good evening to everybody. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be here to be able to talk to you about my experiences in space. I wish we had a little bit more time to talk it because, you know, a lot happens in 20 years and a lot happens in space. And it's an incredible experience to be able to have been a part of this and to continue to be a part of it. The best part of it is the people and the quality of the people that we work with in the space program. And they are the ones who make this happen. They are the ones who, not the crew necessarily, but the ones who put the shuttle together, the ones who keep it safe, and the ones who help us in space and operate from mission control and all the other departments that happen. And thousands of people around the country contribute to this. I'm very fortunate to have been the tip of the iceberg on that and have been able to go into space three times. I'm now the program manager for the safety contract at Johnson Space Center, and in fact, I'm honored that some of my safety professional employees are here to listen tonight, so I'm sure they'd be happy to talk to you after this is over and tell you about their experiences. I'm going to show a short video, and I'll run through a few slides very quickly to try to give you a flavor of what it's like to live and work on the space station, and Peggy will then follow up because she flew two missions behind me and was, in fact, my backup when I was preparing to go into space. She kindly didn't break my leg or anything to jump the line, but helped me get prepared and helped me train, and then did a fantastic job on her own once she got into space as the science officer on her mission. Without further ado, let's go to the video, and I believe it'll start in a couple of seconds once they get the machine running, and this will be 129 days compressed into 5 minutes, and I'm going to talk really fast. This is my second favorite shuttle crew. These are the ones who took us into space. It only took two attempts to successfully launch on August the 12th. And 2 days later, we docked with the station, spent 8 days with the Expedition 2 crew, learning all we could from them and transferring supplies. And then we closed that hatch between the station and the shuttle, realizing at that time we weren't going to open it again for 4 months. And that's a very strange feeling when you look at each other and realize it's just you. But we got to work really quickly. This is one of our experiments. Wasn't our favorite one because notice how his leg jumps there. We were running a shot of electricity through your leg to see how your spinal column responds in zero G. We were all volunteers. This was an experiment on cancer cells that I'll talk a little bit more about in a few minutes. But we would grow four different types of cancer cells and preserve them for analysis down here on Earth. We had a cardiopulmonary experiment to see how your lungs function in zero G without the gravity pulling your diaphragm down and the shape of your lungs changing due to being in space. They're concerned about workload, EVAs, spacewalks, and how people respond to being up there for long periods of time. We also did some maintenance. They trusted me to actually change the hard drive on the computers, and even though we'd only trained on that about 6 months prior, we did have good procedures and didn't have any quality assurance experts up there with me, but they were looking over the shoulder on the TV. And thankfully, the computer worked when I plugged it back in. We also did four spacewalks. Vladimir here is working with the Orlan, the Russian spacesuit that we used on four different occasions. They went out on the first spacewalk and installed this arm, mechanical arm, that goes on the outside of the Russian segment. It's mechanically operated by cranks, but can move people and payloads all around the outside of the station. They spent a few hours doing that and then installed some new antennas and targets on this new module that had just arrived, so that we could then dock Soyuz and Progress vehicles to this docking port, giving us three places that we could dock Russian vehicles to. and we actually used that port during the mission. On the second EVA, they carried this science package developed in Japan by the Japanese Space Agency, installed it on the outside of the service module. Then you kind of unfold it kind of like an accordion-shaped book and expose all these panels with different materials and substances on them to space for 1 to 2 years. And then they'll fold it back up, bring it back inside, and return it to Earth once the shuttle starts flying again. Halfway through the mission, we had a Soyuz vehicle visit us with three crew members on board to replace the vehicle that had been up there for 6 months. The Soyuz needs to be changed out about every 6 months because of certification on the equipment. And so they brought us a brand new one. Claude Agnier was the science officer and flight engineer. She's a French astronaut on her second mission. Victor and Constantine came with her. They spent 8 days working very hard on their experiments and then got into the older Soyuz and closed the hatch, and then 3 hours later landed in Kazakhstan successfully. We also had two Progress vehicles visit us during our stay. The Progress brings up fuel, water, food, supplies, clothing, experiments, you name it, 7 tons crammed into that vehicle. It takes us about 2 to 3 weeks to unload it, and then we start reloading it with all the trash that's accumulated up there. And then when the Progress undocks, it re-enters the atmosphere, burns up, and we hope burns up all the trash, but it goes into the Pacific. Michael here is showing off the sleep station in the Russian compartment that he slept in. I had one opposite across the hall. You can see the nice window that they provide for you, computer. This was Thanksgiving dinner, and I'm carving the turkey out of the foil with my Swiss Army knife. I taught them the great American tradition of fixing a lot more food than you can eat, and we had a fantastic Thanksgiving with the sweet potatoes and rice and gravy and big desserts and everything, and they really liked the idea. They also liked the idea of designating a day to be thankful for what you have in your life, and we talked about that a lot and shared a lot of ideas. Of course, with all that feasting, you've got to exercise and work it off, and so we spent 2 to 2.5 hours every day either on a bicycle or on a treadmill or lifting weights. That's important because you want to be able to function when you get back to Earth, and you've got to keep that load on your body in order to do that. Haircuts were an important part because we had a lot of PR and we had to be on TV a lot. Being the commander, I had the two guys cut each other's hair first, and I took the one with the worst haircut. Early December, we opened the hatch and welcomed Expedition 4 and the STS-108 crew, my real favorite crew because they brought me back to Earth. And we spent 8 days working with them. Since they got there in time to get us home for the holidays, we left our Christmas decorations with them and hung them up and closed the hatch and said goodbye to the station. And then 2 days later, we landed in the Kennedy Space Center in Florida and had a great reunion with our families. And as a matter of fact, that was December 17th also, George, 2 years ago this Sunday. And it was a great day and a very happy day in our lives, but a very proud time to be able to say we had successfully completed our mission. And if we could go to the slides at this point, what happened to the keyboard? I guess I'll push this button maybe. That's our mission patch. Yeah, I see it. We were Expedition 3. The names of my Russian crewmates, Mikhail Turin and Vladimir Dezhurov, are in Cyrillic on the outside. The book here depicts the idea that we're turning the pages on Phase 1, the Shuttle Mir program, which Vladimir and I were both heavily involved in, written on by the American and Russian partners. All the blank pages here represent the future of the future history to be written in space. Particularly by the 16 partners that participate in the International Space Station, with the star representing all the crew members from those countries that will eventually fly to the station, and the rising sun in the background. My crewmates were very experienced. Vladimir had flown in space before as the commander of Mir 18. He was the commander of the first mission that had an American on board, Norm Thagard. And Vladimir is the one who is shaking Hoot Gibson's hand in the famous picture after the first docking of the shuttle with the Mir station. He was also a Russian fighter pilot, a MiG pilot, so he and I had a lot to talk about during the time we were up there. But he was a great guy to work with and a terrific individual on a spacewalk and very experienced, very comfortable to work, to be outside with. Mikhail, or Michael as he preferred to be called, as a flight engineer, he had worked for Energia, the Russian space contractor for over 20 years, helped develop the docking algorithms for the automatic rendezvous system, had not flown in space, but acted as if he'd been there his whole life from the very first day, and did a fantastic job helping take care of all our equipment and keeping things safe. These two guys had trained for over 4 years preparing for this mission because they were the backups for the first expedition to Bill Shepard and his crew. And then the three of us joined up at about a year and a half before our mission and trained together for the remainder of the time. But they were fantastic folks. It's real easy to take a group picture in space. Everybody can be on the front row. This picture is actually upside down, but it doesn't really matter. This is the crew that took us into orbit, STS-105, and then Expedition 2, Yuri, Jim, and Susan, who had been in space for over 5 months and still looked pretty good, and then the three of us as we were getting ready to take over the station. We do have a Soyuz vehicle up there all the time. As I mentioned, the Soyuz is there primarily when we're there as a lifeboat, as a way to leave the station if there are any problems. So each one of us has a pressure suit. This suit was built by the company Svezda, same company that built the suit that Yuri Gagarin flew, and not the same suit, but these guys are incredible, and this is an amazingly reliable and simple suit. You climb into it, you unzip the front, there's a big bladder that you get into, you back into it, pull it up over your head, and then you take the bladder and wad it up in front of you and wrap a couple of rubber bands around it and stuff it inside and zip it up, and that'll hold your pressure. And it works, because we tested it in a vacuum chamber. But a very simple, reliable design, but one that they just continue improving on. And you can see my name in both English and Cyrillic up there. This is the structural heart of the station. This is the node Unity, and there are six ports where you can dock other modules to around the perimeter. And at each end, we're looking aft in this picture, and through here is the module Zarya, the functional cargo block that Brewster and I watched launch from Moscow Mission Control 5 years ago. And that was the first module. This was the second module carried up by the American crew on the shuttle, led by Bob Cabana, just about 5 years ago also. We have the airlock, joint airlock attached here. This is our gym where we lift weights. Now, you're going to say lifting weights in zero-G is pretty easy, right? and it would be, but they have these bungees that they attach to the bar, and the docs make us keep cranking up the number on the bungees as we go through the mission. Down here is where our habitation module might be attached someday if we ever get funding for it. And then over here is what we call our water wall. That's 2 tons of water in 100-pound bags that we keep stored there. Now, obviously, we use the water for drinking and preparing our food. We use it for hygiene. But we also use it to produce the atmosphere that we breathe on the station. We run that water through an electrolysis machine in the Russian segment. It separates it into oxygen and hydrogen. We dump the hydrogen overboard, and then the oxygen is enough to support up to 6 people a day working through that machine. Very reliable and almost a closed-loop system, but not quite. Looking at that module from the outside, actually from one of the Russian modules through a hatch window, that's the Unity. This is the airlock. Up here is the lab Destiny. The functional cargo block, the Soyuz that's attached on the bottom of the station, and then the Canadian arm that we use on the American segment for moving payloads around, and another exposure payload here called Missy. Looking aft from there is the service module where the galley, the toilet, the sleeping quarters are. On the outside, you can see the handrails we use for EVA, some of the tethers, and back here is the progress vehicle, the resupply vehicle that's also used for reboosting the station, and that's why it's located on the tail end. You can see all the windows in the Russian segment. They're all over the place. We have one window in the American segment, unfortunately, but it's a nice big one. This is a Soyuz vehicle on its way to the station. This is the one that came and visited us halfway during the mission. And this is the deorbit module, and this is the on-orbit module. The crew rides in here for both ascent and entry. It's about 2 meters across. You've got 3 people crammed into seats with their knees pulled up into their chest. They spend 2 days in that little module before they ever get to the station. So by the time we open the hatch and let them out, they're real happy to see us, have a chance to stretch their legs. But the Soyuz is a very reliable vehicle, hundreds of successful launches for the booster, and it's supported their space program remarkably well. And fortunately, we have it now so that we can continue occupation of the station and continue operations up there with the help of our Russian friends. This is the crew that visited us, as I mentioned, Victor, Claudie, and Konstantin. And this is the cancer experiment I mentioned where we grow the cells for several days at a time, fix them, and then put them in a refrigerator to return them to Earth so they can be analyzed. The reason we grow cells, and I hate to talk about this in front of Peggy because she's a physiologist and a scientist who works these kind of experiments. In fact, she taught me how to protect the experiment from myself, which is the reason for the mask and the gloves, not to protect me from the cells. But the scientists get really picky if you contaminate their experiment. But anyway, growing them in zero G is a good way to simulate what happens in the human body. When they grow them in a lab down on Earth, if it's just in a dish, they tend to grow in two dimensions rather than three. In zero G, they'll grow in three dimensions, and they get a better idea of the growth patterns and what they might be able to do to stop that growth. I was lucky enough to participate in one of our four EVAs. I'm sort of reflected in the helmet there. That's a picture of Vladimir. This is like Buzz Aldrin on the moon. There are no pictures of me in space on the spacewalk because I had the camera. But there are a lot of pictures of Vladimir. And we went outside to connect some cables and reconfigure the outside after the new Russian module came up there so it could be used for rendezvous and docking and also to test out the arm. And we spent 5 hours out there, which was a fantastic experience. And just to summarize it real quickly for you, about an hour into the EVA, I said, I really got to look around and experience this because I was concentrating on what I was doing. And a lot of it was just like training because I'm looking at the handrails and making sure my two tethers are still attached, and you keep checking those a lot. About an hour into it, I was up on the top of the station working on the cable connectors, and I kind of raised up almost to a standing position with the tethers still there. And I looked around, and imagine yourself on top of a 747 at 40,000 feet over the Pacific, holding on to two ropes and just riding on top with no wind blast. And that's what it's like on top of the station, because you've got this long fuselage out in front of you, these wings spread out, the solar arrays to either side, and then nothing but the horizon all around you. And it was just a fantastic view. And I checked those tethers again and pulled myself back in. It's just you and the helmet. I mean, everything's self-contained. Everything you need is inside that suit. And it's remarkably reliable, both the Russian and the American suits. And very easy to work in. But it takes a lot of training to get there. And it's a fantastic experience. Peggy also did an EVA, and I'm sure she'll tell you a little bit about that. This is the Canadian arm. It's similar to the shuttle arm. It has an end effector to pick things up and move people hardware around the outside of the station. The neat thing about the station arm, unlike the shuttle arm, is, you know, we have a shoulder, an elbow, and a wrist, and it's very versatile. On this one, you can grab a grapple fixture on the outside of the station and let go with the shoulder, and that now becomes your end effector or your hand. And so you can inchworm around the outside of the station or attach it to a little cart that we have on top of the truss that will actually move it back and forth up to 360 feet when it's complete to carry people and hardware around the outside of the station on a little railroad car. So It's a really neat piece of equipment. And this is where we control it from inside the lab. It's like a fantastic Nintendo game. You got three screens and two hand controllers and a bunch of switches. And my kids think this is great. I thought it was pretty great, too. We had a ham radio on board, which was a nice way to talk informally to the ground and to stay in touch with people and keep up with things. It came in very handy, or it was actually very helpful, both psychologically and news-wise for us after September the 11th. We were up there on September the 11th, and I managed to stay in touch with a lot of people through that. We also did contacts with schools all over the world through the ham radio, and what they do is they send their questions in ahead of time. Mission Control sends them up to you on the station, and after a couple of weeks, I finally trained them to send the answers along with the questions. So I didn't embarrass myself or NASA, the kids had great questions, and it's a line of sight communication with them. So I would set the computer up next to the ham radio, review the questions, and then I would watch to see when we would come over the horizon so they could start talking to us. And they were always well rehearsed and well done. And I was setting up near the end of the, well, early in the mission, I talked to a school in Virginia, and I got an email from Kathy Thornton, who was in my astronaut class and is now a professor at UVA. And she said her daughter, Laura, who was born during my first mission, by the way, STS-38. Laura was in the class that was talking to me through the ham radio, and she said they were really excited. It was a fantastic experience, and they'd been waiting 4 years to do this. So I sent her a note back saying, why so long? And she said, well, there's a huge list, and there's not many people doing it, and not much opportunity. So I asked the ground how often we were going to do these, and they said about every 2 weeks or so. And I said, we got to do more than that. There's a long list to get through, and it's fun. And so we started doing them three or four times a week and at various times in the day. And near the end of the mission, I was setting up to talk to a school in Canada, a little bit outside Ottawa. And I set the computer up, and I always checked to see what time it was locally so, you know, I'd know whether they'd had lunch yet or recess. I looked at the clock, and it was 4 a.m. So I went back to the lab and called the ground. I said, I think there's been a mistake in the timing. And they said, no, that's what they gave us. And I said, well, what do you want me to do? They said, well, call, see if anybody's there. Maybe the janitor will answer or something. So So at the appointed time, I called and gave the call sign, and there was about a one-second delay, and then somebody keyed a mic, and 200 or 300 kindergarten through fifth grade kids and their parents in this big auditorium were yelling and screaming and cheering. They were so excited to be talking to somebody in space, they managed to get these kids up and come in at 4 o'clock in the morning to do this. You couldn't get my kids to do that. But it was really a fantastic experience. And what that told me in all these contacts with the ground and with the schools was that the next generation, and this is one of the two really important points I want to make, I'm finally getting to it, the next generation assumes that we're going to continue doing this. They assume that they and their peers are going to have easy and reliable and frequent access to space. The shuttle is the beginning of that, and the station is the beginning of that, but they're looking for a lot bigger things, and they expect it to happen. I mean, kids love space and dinosaurs, and the dinosaurs aren't coming back. The space is what they're looking for. And some of us are still here, I guess, but they believe in it, and they trust us to keep that going. If we let them down, it's going to be a huge disappointment. They're going to have to start over like some of us did. When I was a kid, I thought I'd be, if I ever got to be an astronaut, I'd have a shot at being on a Mars mission. I'd really like to do that. Well, my son knew that, and shortly before I went into space, he was about 10 or 11. I was putting him to bed one night, and he said, hey, you know, Dad, you're getting pretty old. And I said, well, what's your point? He said, well, I know you wanted to go to Mars, but they probably won't be able to do that while you're still an astronaut. So I'll tell you what, I'll do it for you. And I said, that's a great idea, and I think you can do it. And, in fact, I think somebody in his generation will do that. Will have the opportunity to go to Mars. The first human on Mars is probably alive and well on the Earth today and getting ready for it and training for it and learning. And I really hope that's happening. And I said, well, Frank, I think you can do that, and I really hope you do. And, in fact, by that time, I'll probably be about John Glenn's age, and maybe I can go with you. We saw some great sights from space. This is out in the Gulf of Mexico, not too far from here. This is an algae bloom that's being stirred up by the Mississippi River Delta. The slide doesn't quite do it justice, but it's fantastic sights. This is the Kennedy Space Center where we launch from and where we land. To give you an idea of scale and how good our cameras were, that runway on the bottom there is a shuttle landing facility, and that's about 3 miles long. That's Pad A and Pad B where we launched from. But we had a great crew, a great time up there. That's me upside down in the middle. That's our living quarters, our table, sleeping quarters. Back there is the progress and the toilet. And in fact, people ask you what you do with your spare time up there, and our families are allowed to send us care packages up on the progress and books and movies and things like that. So my kids picked this out. It's the worst case scenario survival handbook for travel. And it has a chapter on how to survive an alien abduction on a UFO. Seriously. And so the first time I called the kids on a family conference, they said, did you find a little red book? And I said, oh, yeah, I got it. And they said, well, did you read the right chapter? And I said, yeah. And they said, you'll be okay. Don't worry. I was supposed to welcome the shuttle up on the day the Navy was supposed to beat Army in 2001. But the shuttle got delayed. So there were two Academy graduates coming up on that cruise, so I figured we'd have a pretty good cheering section. Well, they didn't make it, so I had to simulate my crewmates there. So I suited up the space suits and got my Beat Army sign out and sent that down to the team the day before the game, but it didn't do any good. We still lost. But we had an Army-type season that year. We were 0-11. Army's 0-13 this year. But I did want to put this up here because we had a really good day last Saturday. And got a little revenge. And I also wanted to put in a little plug for on December 30th, these guys will be in town to play Texas Tech. And I hope everybody goes out and cheers for the right team. And Phil's Reliant Stadium. And, of course, on December 22nd, there's a major powerhouse battle in the basketball world when Rice and Navy meet to play each other, and I know that there's going to be a huge national interest in that game. I was preparing for it up there. I'm a basketball coach with the Y, and so I had to show the kids I actually can dunk it under certain circumstances. This is the crew that relieved us, Expedition 4. They actually have the American record for duration in space, 193 days, and they were up there a long time, but they did a fantastic job. The mission that came up to pick us up, that's their patch. I just want to say one last thing before, because I've taken way too much time, but And by the way, this is an artist rendition by Pat Rawlings, another SAIC employee who makes a great calendar and does a lot of good space art to motivate people. The future is in space. I mean, there's lots of frontiers that need to be conquered and lots of things that need to be solved down here. But space is where we're going to continue to grow forever, continue to learn. And we don't know what we're going to learn. We don't know what's out there. We can't go to Congress and say, we want to go to space because we're going to learn this, this, and this. It's hard for us to go to Congress and say, we want to go to space because it's there. But really, that's what we need to be doing. We need to go, in my opinion, and I'm not speaking for anybody in an official capacity, we really need to go back to the moon and learn how to operate there so we can go on to other planets and continue to expand human presence throughout the solar system and beyond. We can do that. I mean, humanity has proven it can do whatever it puts its mind to. We just have to have the will and the political backing and the financial backing, and those are not simple things. We also need a lot of courage, and we need to maintain our leadership in what we're doing. It takes a lot of political courage to send a crew out on a mission to Mars where you know they're going to be gone for 3 years, and if something goes wrong, you can't get them back overnight. That's why we ought to go to the moon and learn how to do it really well before we go that far. But my last point is we are the leaders in space in the world. We are the people who have set the pace and built what we have now, along with the help of our partners. But we are the leaders, and there are people all around the world who would love to step into that leadership role if we step out of it. I've worked with a lot of them. I've worked with the Japanese, the Germans, the French, the Russians. I haven't worked with the Chinese yet, but we know where they're trying to go. They would love to be able to have the resources and the ability to do that. They don't. They don't. They can't match what we can do. And when the shuttle starts flying again, we're gonna prove how good we are at it and get the space station finished and keep moving up and out. But that leadership is very, very important, and people look to us for that. They count on us. They depend on us. And the kids that are following us, they really depend on us to do that. So thank you very much. Now you can hear really good.
Thank you very much, Frank. That was very good, and certainly your point is very well taken. Our third speaker this evening, as I said, is a Rice graduate. Peggy, she's her doctorate here at Rice in biochemistry. And so this is a return to Rice for Peggy, but she's an adjunct professor here as well. Let me turn it over to Peggy.
Well, it's actually kind of special to be able to come back to Rice and talk here, in part because I did spend a number of years here getting my PhD. But I've always said I've never had a real job, because as soon as I finished my PhD here at Rice, I went and started working at NASA. I've always been able to have the opportunity to live my dream and to work for NASA. And so it's always been very special to me to be so close to Rice and to be able to share these experiences with you. I wanted to talk about my space flight, and it's interesting. It happened about a year after Frank's. It was fun. I got to back up Frank on his mission, and then shortly after that, launch. I was kind of unique in that I was the first U.S. person to go to the space station as a rookie. And so a lot of people had concerns about it, but Frank seemed to think I might be okay, so I was convinced that it'd probably be all right. I had the opportunity, because I'd worked for NASA so many years, I had the opportunity to watch a launch. The closest you can stand to the launch pad is 3 miles away, and it is quite impressive. If you ever have an opportunity even to see a launch, it is amazing, because you can actually feel the sound waves as the vehicle takes off and lifts up. And here's just another view of the vehicle as it's taking off. I was on STS-111 in the Endeavour space shuttle. Are my crewmates, Valeri Korzun here on the left. He'd flown in space on the Mir space station before. And he was actually the guy, you may have heard of the fire on the Mir space station. This was the firefighter. And so I felt like I was in pretty good hands with him. And Sergei Treshov was my also crewmate, also a rookie going into space for the first time. And this is Valeri doing one of his favorite things. He was the photographer for our mission, loved to take pictures, especially of the Earth. And obviously he had the biggest lens on board, so everyone else had lens envy. I like this picture because it, you know, one of the questions that I'm always asked is, you know, what's it like to float in zero gravity? And it's so hard to explain that it just requires no effort at all. It is you know, just simple to float in zero gravity. I try and explain it to young people by saying it's like swimming in a pool, except you don't have to worry about breathing because you're in air, and of course you can't push against anything to move away from it because there's just not enough molecules in the air. I also like it because it's got the speed limit sign, 17,500 miles per hour. And it's pretty amazing to think that you're actually going that fast. Sometimes you really do get an impression of speed, but most of the time it doesn't seem even possible, remotely possible, that you could be traveling around the world once every 90 minutes. This is Sergey again, and he was in the Sokol suit, and Frank told you a little bit about this suit. This was the pressure suit we used in the Soyuz vehicle. We get in about halfway through the mission. You may have heard that in zero gravity, your spinal columns spreads out and you get a little bit taller, and so we get in and do a little fit check. I also think they thought we might have gotten fatter. Wasn't a problem. This is the crew that I went up with. It was quite an interesting gang. Taco and Paco from Texas. Philippe Perrin from France. Franklin Chang Diaz from Costa Rica. Really certified smart guy working on engines that are hopefully going to get us to the Mars in 3 months or less. And then our crew. And actually, you may have noticed from Frank's picture when he left, these three guys were the guys that he left, and we handed over with those three guys as Expedition 5 when we arrived. And it's that time period when we're together is actually very important, because even though after years of training, it's really important to understand the intricacies of how things really work on orbit, and it's a very important time. Here, Carl and I are doing robotics ops. Frank told you about the little train that goes along the truss. We were installing the device that allowed us to move the arm up to that little train that moves along the truss so that we can move the arm around and get it in different positions. This is actually the sleep station that I slept in. Frank showed you a view of the Russian sleep station. This was the one in the U.S. segment. We have two in one. And it's just a sleeping bag attached to the wall, which is kind of interesting. You know, I always get questions about, well, is it hard to sleep in space? And actually, some people do have some difficulty sleeping in space. And I did initially the first couple of days. I'm one of those people that when you fall asleep, you kind of jerk. Well, you kind of move somewhere if you do that. And you bump into something. Then you wake up, and you're like, oh, I'm falling. And then you have to try to fall asleep again. So what worked for me was just loosely bungeeing, crisscrossing across my body, making me feel like I was laying against something, and after that I slept like a baby. And I was able to do a number of different scientific experiments. I arrived with what we call a mini pressurized logistics module that allowed us to bring up a lot of different scientific experiments, and this is just one I was working on. It was on zeolite crystal growth. I like to show it because just to remind everybody, you know, we get to use all surfaces in zero gravity. This happened to be on the ceiling. And, you know, we use all the surfaces for either hardware all around us. So it's not just like your standard laboratory here that you might walk into, you know, and you have experiments here and experiments here. You've got them up here and down here. And, you know, all your hardware, your avionics hardware is in one place or the other. It can be anywhere around the station. Frank actually showed you the pulmonary function experiment. It was another good one. We looked in particular at the pulmonary function before and after EVA, because like the divers who come to the surface, we're interested in that pressure difference that can be caused, and we were looking at lung function to see if we could see any differences that might, you know, potentially result in bends like decompression sickness before or after an EVA. So. And we did a lot of environmental monitoring. We monitor the acoustics level of the vehicle. We monitor toxic levels in the air, in the water, and our hearing as well. This was a test of our own hearing. As I said, we got to bring up a lot of neat things on board the shuttle that I arrived on. This whole rack here is what we refer to as the microgravity sciences glove box. And the upper portion up here is actually an enclosed section. You can actually pull it out, and it's got gloves on it, and you can put your hands in. And inside there, we can do experiments that are a little more toxic or hazardous, because if you think about it, here on the ground, if you were doing something that was a little toxic or hazardous, you have some way to easily get ventilation away from you, or to, you know, if you can always open a window. Up there, you don't necessarily have that option to clean your air out. So we use this to allow us to do a little bit more interesting science. We did a couple of different things in there. We were looking at superconductor crystallization methods. So we were melting samples at 835 degrees and looking at how they recrystallize, because obviously the bigger the superconductor crystal you can get, the better your electronics development may be in the future. And using microgravity as a tool like that allows us to understand how we can change our processes here on Earth to optimize it. So it's not just something that we could do in space, but just the simple understanding of the intricacies of what makes it work better in space will allow us to develop different methods here on the ground that can enhance our ability to make bigger superconductors here as well, superconductor crystals. And again, you know, you can approach problems from any different direction in zero gravity, and it's hard to remember that all the time because we're so used to thinking of things in two dimensions. And I just like to show that just to remind everybody that you can come at things different ways. I came from Iowa originally. I'm a farmer's daughter, and so growing soybeans in space was a big deal to me. My dad thought it was too. His bushels per acre were probably a little greater than mine, but my little 8 soybean plants did okay. And here's a shot of Sergey. Space is a big deal on board. We have progress vehicles bringing up supplies, and they do take the progress vehicles. We do take trash away in those. We have shuttles bringing up different other supplies, and so we have a lot of stowage issues on board the station. And here we had, Valeri and Sergey had built a stowage enclosure to allow us more stowage space inside one of the sections that had other avionics hardware. And Valeri suggested Sergey try it on for size. So every month we do a cardiovascular fitness test just for the docs on the ground to keep track of us. But I think it's, And it looks, you know, kind of sloppy how we do things there, but it's really actually very neat. You Velcro or you attach one corner of a piece of hardware, and it works out great, but it looks kind of messy to look at all the cables and things floating around all the time. Sergey and I also had done some repairs on the treadmill. We told you that exercise was really important, so anytime the exercise hardware goes down, it's kind of a big deal. And we were doing some maintenance here. And then Sergey, we had pulled it out, and of course on the ground it weighs probably 800 pounds or so. He was trying to impress us with his physical prowess there. Of the 6 months on orbit, I mean, it was phenomenal every day getting a chance to contribute to the science programs of investigators that had been putting ideas together for years. But the most impressive time of that 8 months was the time that I got to spend outside doing the EVA. And if you think about it, as Frank described, you know, it's an amazing experience being outside. You're in your own little spacecraft, in essence. And that's a pretty big deal because, you know, you have to have some way of regulating temperatures, you know, when you're in the shade at minus 270 degrees up to plus 270 degrees Celsius in the sunlight. And you have to have your own oxygen system, your own carbon dioxide removal system. So it's a very complicated little vehicle that you get into to go out and do these spacewalks. And this is the special thermal underwear we had. It's got little liquid tubes that run through the underwear that help with the liquid cooling. And this is the Russian spacesuit. I also did my spacewalk in a Russian spacesuit. And the name of the Russian spacesuit is Orlan, which means eagle. And actually, after I had the opportunity to do a space flight, I thought it was a perfect name for a spacesuit because I'd never had such an incredible sensation of flying as I ever did. At one point during the time, the arm, that the mechanical arm that we were talking about, I was on the end of it, and Valeri had cranked me out, and I was out and away from structure, so I could see the incredible structure here. I'm like 40 feet away from the structure. The ground is going by at 17,500 miles per hour below, and I'm just hanging on the end. And the folks on the ground said the next day, they sent it up in a little daily summary, you must have been having fun. You were giggling a lot. And learning how to cut hair in space is kind of a big deal. Frank kind of indicated, you know, you pick the guy with the worst haircut to cut yours. Well, It was funny because, you know, one time the ground called and said, hey, we've been trying to get a hold of you for an hour. What happened? You know, what's going on? Didn't you hear us call? And I'm like, no, but, you know, we had, you know, two huge acts of courage on board the station today. One was I decided to let Valerie cut my hair, and the second was that he agreed. So, but, you know, using a vacuum cleaner to clean up all the little pieces of hair, because, of course, you know, you breathe that in, get it in your eyes. So one person holds the vacuum cleaner while the other person is clipping. It's kind of an ordeal to do. Being on board the station for 6 months, the one thing people say, well, what did you miss the most? Well, really, I had a phenomenal time. But if I said I missed anything, it was the variety of food. And so we had an 8-day food cycle. And, you know, you have three different meals for 8 days, and then you start over again. And the first 8 days, not a big deal. Second 8 days, not too bad. Not third 8 days, not too bad. You know, 3 months in, you're like, wow. And Valerie was always impressed that I could tell him exactly how many chicken fajitas were in each container and exactly, you know, all my favorites. I knew exactly how many of them there were and everything. So we had to become a little more creative about the things we were making. And so I decided, let's make hamburgers. So we you know, took the buns and we'd pull them apart. And, of course, making hamburgers is almost a three-person job when you're doing it in zero gravity. Because, you know, you have used condiments to hold things together. So you put, like, some cheese on and slap on the patty that you rehydrated. And then you, yeah. My mom said, so how do you grill the patty? I'm like, Mom, you add water. And then if we were lucky, we just had a progress arrive. We might have a fresh tomatoes or fresh onions, you know. So you use, you know, a little ketchup, mayo, and hold everything together. And then, you know, when you get done, you have a finished product, it works out pretty well. And then you start on the next one. Because it took three of you to build the first one. The biggest challenge is trying to keep track of all of them before, you know, by the time you get to the end of the third one. After 4.5 months, we had the first shuttle come to visit us. These were our first visitors. And they arrived with the S1 truss. And the important thing I wanted to point out here is just how little the clearance is on there. There was only a few inches on either side and a couple of feet from the back end of the tail of the orbiter. It was 30,000 pounds of truss. And the reason that's important is that fancy computer station that Frank was telling you about, that's like a little video game, is all you have. You don't have windows to look out of to see, you know, where am I, how am I doing, but you're relying on those computer screens and the computers to tell you where your arm is and making sure that you don't hit anything on the way out. So it was a pretty big deal. Obviously, this crew thought that the S1 truss was their most important payload. However, I told the commander, Jeff Eshby, that I wasn't opening the hatch unless he had salsa. So a picture of us all together, he opened the hatch and he had salsa, so I let him in. But this is the crew that came up to join us. They spent 8 days working with us, and we installed that large piece of truss onto the vehicle using the robotic workstation here. And then they had an EVA team that would go out and make all the physical connections for all the thermal and the electrical systems. They also brought a pecan pie for my husband. But Valeria made a command decision. He said we weren't going to eat it until after they left because we'd have to share it if we did. And this is Sandy and I at the robotic workstation during the installation. She obviously had a much better tan than I did. And then Valeria was assisting Piers as he was getting ready for the EVA. I mentioned that decompression, the potential for decompression sickness, and we care about that because the suits are at a higher pressure and then returning back to a lower pressure when you come back onto the vehicle. You have that potential for the bends. I said that the wrong way. No, I didn't. I said it the right way, didn't I?
Suits are at a lower pressure.
Suits are at a lower pressure. So when you come back, you come into a higher pressure. And the potential for the bends exists, so we use 100% pre-breathe with exercise before they go out to get their body re-equilibrated so there's less nitrogen in there to cause the bends. One of the hardest things to convey about the space station is how big it is. And I try and use these slides, the next few slides, to illustrate how large the station is. So this is a crew member. This is halfway down one of those pieces of truss that we installed. It's about 22 feet from the end, so that's about half of the total length of the truss. Another crew member took the picture of the second crew member out there. And so you keep in mind how large that person is, and I'll show you. This is the entire piece of truss starting from here out to here. So, you know, a crew member is a very small part of that. And I have another one. Kind of illustrates from the bottom the whole structure. You know, this is the laboratory module that the U.S. node Frank talked about and the airlock. And then we're adding this truss here. I'll come back to the truss and explain why we're doing that. And then we have the FGB, which is basically our big storage closet. And then the service module, which is the habitation module that has the kitchen, the galley, and a toilet. And then there's another module that actually sticks out here. It's not real obvious. It's called the docking compartment, where we did our EVAs from, the Russian EVAs. And then the Progress vehicle in the back and the Soyuz vehicle attached here. And then you can see how large this robotic arm is that we used to install this truss. And interestingly enough, the arm attaches to the truss with a pin that's about this long. And so the entire 30,000 pounds is controlled by the arm grabbing onto that pin. And we move it around and that way. But we're building this truss. Eventually, it'll be the length of a football field. This is only 200 feet here. So eventually, the length of the truss will be the length of a football field, and we'll have four sets of solar arrays that look like this, two at either end. And the reason we need all that power is we're going to add additional modules. We're going to add a node module here, and then the Japanese module, and the European module, the Columbus. So we'll end up having a total of three really neat laboratories, and we need all that power to run all the neat experiments inside those laboratories. So that's why we're building the truss on orbit now. And as Frank mentioned, you can see just incredible number of different things when you're looking out the window. We have a lot of projects where scientists on the ground determine what we need to look at and what they want to look at over a course of time. We look at some active events. This is a forest fire. I just picked one of the pictures that I like just because of the colors. Every time you look out the window, even if it was an area you'd been over numerous times, the light angle would be different. Somehow it would look different. You'd notice something you hadn't seen before. It's always impressive. This one I think is a work of art. This is a coral reef, the Great Barrier Reef, actually. Another active event that was going on, Mount Etna erupted while we were on orbit, and Blurry got some great shots of that eruption. Shortly after the first shuttle, the shuttle arrived with the S1 truss, and then as soon as they departed, we expected the arrival of another Soyuz. Again, this is that six-month rotation required because of the lifetime issues on the Soyuz. In order to keep a vehicle up there that's active and ready to go at any time, we have to rotate those out every 6 months. And we had a Belgian astronaut and two cosmonauts that came and stayed with us and did scientific experiments for about 10 days. This was getting near the end of my mission, though, and it was really hard for me to decide it was okay to leave. I was having such a great time on orbit, and I was pretty introspective about it. My husband reminded me, you know, it's better to leave a place while you still want to stay than the other way around. So I was like, okay, well, maybe I should go home. But it's still hard to go home because not every day on the ground you get to be Superwoman. And then STS-113 arrived, and this was also the Endeavor. I went up on the Endeavor, and this was my ride home. And then in this payload bay, they were also carrying another truss. And this was the P1 truss, the port side truss. And it was a very similar piece of hardware. We were going to install it on the other side and balance out the station. The one complication was because of the configuration of the arm on board the station, we couldn't reach all the way into the payload bay. So we had an arm on the shuttle, and they picked it up with the shuttle arm and held it up while we grabbed it with the station arm. Then they let go with the shuttle arm, And then we did the install from there. So first 30,000-pound handoff in space. And this is kind of gives you a feel for kind of how large the arm is. This is a crew member right here. And this is just what we call the wrist joint. You know, that's just the wrist. We've got the whole arm here. And he's holding a piece of hardware that was attached to the truss. We had to move it around. I'd like to show this shot just to give a feel for how beautiful some parts of the station are. Because we're going around the Earth at once every 90 minutes, we get to see a sunrise and a sunset in that 90-minute time frame, which is pretty impressive. And during that time frame, seeing the limb of the Earth, the curvature of the Earth, is very impressive. The sunrise, the colors that you see, the colors are hard to explain because it's so much richer than anything you might imagine it would be. I've used the analogy that it's like living your whole life in semi-darkness, and somebody turns on the light when you go into space because it's just so amazing. And the richness, the textures, and the colors seem so much more impressive. And then going outside to do a spacewalk is like, you know, going outside for the first time after you've lived in semi-darkness this whole time. So it's pretty impressive to be able to see all of this structure. Because we have all these windows kind of on the station, they're relatively close, and most of them look down at the Earth. We don't actually get to see the vehicle that we're building, except when we're arriving and departing away from the vehicle. And so this was just a view as we were departing. You can see we attached the other side of the truss there and evened it out. And Blurry took this shot of me as we were saying goodbye to the station. And then we had to spend several days getting ready to come home. Unfortunately, we had a lot of bad weather in Florida, and optimally, we would like to land in Florida. So we would try, we would, you know, shut the whole, you have to take the orbiter from being an orbiting vehicle and get it ready to land. So you have to take the galley down, take the toilet down, get everybody dressed up in these orange suits, and get ready for entry, and then they'll say, oh, nope, can't make it. Try again in an hour and a half, or an hour and a half. So we go through that process two or three times, and then at the and eventually they say, okay, we're not going to do it. We're not going to try anymore today. And so then you have to bring the galley back up and bring the toilet back up. Very important. We got pretty good at that whole process of getting undressed and dressed and the galley and the toilet thing going. But we did get a little bored during this time frame, and we built another crew member. Eventually we did get to land. We had the, I guess, the notoriety of having waved off more than any other days than any other crew had. But we did eventually get to land. The station crew members, because we've been on orbit for so long, we actually land in a recumbent position, even though that looks like we're sitting up. We were actually lying down with our feet up, and whereas the shuttle crew members are returning in a seated position because they've only been on orbit for a few days. And touchdown of Endeavour in Florida. And our patch, everybody has to have a patch. It's one of the hardest jobs of designing a mission. You have to come up with a patch. Well, you have to get everybody to agree on something. Valeri didn't want a 5 on there, so I snuck it in with the V on the flags. We got the U.S. and Russian flag, 17 stars for the 17 folks that came to visit us. And our names, of course, but we also have the station at assembly complete to illustrate that we're just a stepping stone along the way. And that's all I have. Okay.
Well, thank you very much. We have, I think, a number of questions, so I think there's a lot of interest here in our audience.
Will this be a written test?
It's okay. You can look on my paper.
Let me read the first one. Maybe, Brewster, you could answer this one. How did you transition from being a military pilot to being an astronaut?
In 1977, I think, NASA solicited applicants for the space shuttle program. Each of the military services set up their own process, and you filled out the application and submitted it, and the military service, in my case the Air Force, did a screening process, forwarded some of those applications on to NASA.
and then NASA went through their own screening process. So it was simply applying for a civil service job.
You want to elaborate on that, Frank?
Well, at the time of the early days of our space program, all of the people that were hired were military test pilots. Somebody decided those were the kind of people you needed to have to fly on rockets. Then eventually they hired scientists during the Apollo program, and we sent scientists to the moon, which seemed to be pretty appropriate. When we got around to Shuttle, there were requirements for both people who would be crew members, flying type crew members, and also people who would do the scientific and other activities aboard the shuttle that were contemplated. And so the solicitation came out for both pilot types like Frank and myself and mission specialist types like Peggy. And so we have people with all kinds of technical degrees, technical backgrounds, doctors, medical doctors, PhDs in all kinds of scientific and technical career fields are part of the program at this time. And when you combine those people with the people who are responsible for flying the machine, you get a great team, and you combine that with the space shuttle system, and you get a greater team that's able to do the wonderful things that you've seen here depicted tonight.
Frank, Peggy, you want to add to that?
Well, my experience was a little bit different. As I mentioned, you know, I did my PhD here and then went to work immediately at the Johnson Space Center. I, of course, had always wanted to be an astronaut. And in fact, watched the first guys walk on the moon, thought, wow, cool job. But it was actually Brewster's class that selected the first female astronauts. And that was the year that I graduated from high school, and I decided, sorry, Brewster. it was timely for me, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be a slip. But it was very, you know, an important time in my life, I guess, you know, graduating from high school and thinking that, you know, I could maybe do this job too. You know, coming from an Iowa farm, you know, this was pretty much a big pie in the sky kind of dream. And luckily I didn't know how hard it would be to get selected, because it took over 10 years of applying before I ever got lucky enough to be selected for an interview, and from that to be selected to be an astronaut. So, yeah, a long process.
But it certainly worked well in your case, Peggy. Frank, do you?
I started thinking about this when I was 13 and wanted to be an astronaut then. And kind of set my sights on that through my whole career with a few sidetracks, but I decided I wanted to be a Navy pilot and went to the academy and became a fighter pilot. And I knew you had to go to test pilot school in order to be selected in those days. And so I applied to test pilot school. I actually applied 4 times before they finally took me, I think to keep me from applying again. I finally finished through there. In the meantime, NASA selected Brewster's class, and then they selected Charlie Bolden's class up there. And I kept applying. But finally, in 1984, I had finished enough of the test pilot training and enough flight experience and all that Mr. Abbey invited me down for an interview. And I was selected in 84. And transitioning from the military to NASA was a transition, but it was something I'd wanted to do my whole life, so there was no pain involved at all. I was very happy to do that, and it's been a great experience to be a part of this and to have the chance to fly in space.
Very good. How would you compare the Russian space equipment and program compared to the U.S. program?
You're looking at me. there's a difference in philosophy in the way the Russian hardware and the American hardware is designed and developed, and you can see that on the roads in our country. Americans would love to have a new car every year or two, and we tend to do that kind of thing, and we like a new model, and the 2003 model better look a little different than the 2001 model, or nobody will know you got a new car. In Russia, you can't really tell what year a car is, because they all look the same pretty much. the ones that are built in Russia every year. And in fact, they tend to last a long, long time and to be very reliable. And they just keep slightly improving the model as they go. Their aviation world has been very similar, and their space program has been very similar, as illustrated by the Soyuz spacecraft, which has been flying for, I guess, 30 years. Mm-hmm. And they just keep improving the model and making changes to it to make it more reliable and safer and more effective. And they tend to do a lot more testing, actual testing of the hardware to destruction, whereas we tend to do a lot more analysis. We have more complicated systems that and rely on a certain amount of redundancy. And for example, on the shuttle, we have three inertial measuring units to make sure that we know where we are in space. But each one of them is identical. We tend to have redundancy in our life support systems. But in the Russian system, for example, on both the Mir and the Russian segment of the station, they have three different ways of producing oxygen that are completely different from each other. So they have dissimilar redundancy, and which keeps you from being bitten by a generic failure that would, you know, take out all three similar systems. And it's a different philosophy, and I think it's the fact that we're partners now and are able to take the best aspects of both approaches and put them together, I think has made it stronger. And another good illustration is the fact that we are still in space and still keeping the space station going because we had the Soyuz system backing up the shuttle system.
You want to add to that?
No, I think Frank covered that pretty well. The Russians really do believe in the philosophy, if it's not broke, don't fix it. And it shows through. They may not have the neatest, newest, fanciest hardware, but it tends to work. And so it is a good melding of our two different technologies to come together, hopefully come out with better of both worlds.
Mm-hmm. Another aspect of their system that's not related to hardware but to their people is the fact that I'll illustrate this by the first meeting I had in Russia to talk about the initial plans to rendezvous with the Mir, with the shuttle. I was a member of an American delegation that was about 10 or 12 people. We were a typical American team, multi-ethnic and both men and women. And I, at that time, was the second oldest on the team. And we had one guy who was older than I was, Gary Cohen, who had actually worked on Apollo Soyuz. The rest of us, you know, were still in high school, Apollo Soyuz, just like you. But actually, I wasn't. I was in the Gulf of Tonkin when that happened. On the Russian side, they had all basically Caucasian males. All of them were over 50, most were over 60. All of them had worked Apollo Soyuz, and all of them had been with the space program their entire careers. So they had incredible continuity, an incredible level of knowledge, and we had very smart people also, but they just beat us hands down in their understanding of what we were up against and what we were trying to do. We worked together very well, and they were very patient with us, but my counterpart in the Shuttle Mir program, Valery Rumin, at the time I took the job, he said, you know, you're my fifth counterpart, because he stayed in the job. He's still in the same job, and he's on like his eighth counterpart now. So they have continuity, and they have corporate knowledge.
Well, Brewster, of course, managed the space station program for the Boeing company and was responsible for integrating a lot of that of those systems with the Russians. Brewster, do you want to add to that?
Well, I agree with Frank. The Russians, when they started in their space program, they didn't have the computational capacity that we had in the United States. They didn't have the powerful computers. The technical guys were all excellent mathematicians, and they would solve things analytically with paper and pencil and slide rules and that sort of thing. So they were very, very smart, analytical thinking people. And I also agree that their philosophy was test it till it breaks so you know what you've got. And on our side, with all our smarts and our computational capacity, we finesse everything. We analyze it to death. And we do a lot less testing than the Russians do in their program. And sometimes it bites us because we're not quite as smart as we think we are, and we don't anchor our analyses and our models with good test data the way we should sometimes. So their philosophy is a very sound philosophy. When you fund them properly, they build excellent stuff and they can do it on time. For example, the FGB that you saw up here was purchased by the United States through a contract with the Boeing company to Khrunichev. So Boeing was responsible for managing the Khrunichev contract, and my good friend Sergei Sheyevich was the program manager for FGB, and he works for Khrunichev. And they were given the money that was required to execute their contract, and they delivered excellent hardware on time and under cost.
Very good. Well, Peggy, maybe you can answer this one. Is it still medically safe to be on the space station for long missions after the recent failure of the different monitoring equipment on the station?
Well, actually, we have had some failures of monitoring equipment, but we still have mechanisms, redundant mechanisms, alternative ways to measure the atmosphere and to keep our own comfort level about the air quality on the station reasonable. We like I said, it's kind of our philosophy on things. We like to have multiple ways to measure things and to reassure ourselves, and you know, the more the better, but you do need to draw the line somewhere. And I don't think we're in a bad situation, and I think our management agreed that we could take the risk without having that additional information. At least at this stage in the game. If we lose additional hardware, then we might have to reassess and decide again later. But I'm very comfortable with the air quality and all our monitoring systems on the station.
Frank?
I agree with Peggy, and in fact, I've been involved in some of the discussions, obviously from the safety community, of where we are. A lot of what you had during the time when people were discussing that was people who were responsible for the air quality or responsible for the hardware, their equipment, their sensors, or the data that they were supposed to be maintaining was not at the 100% level of what they had come to expect and were being expected to answer for. And so they were pointing out that in their area it was not at 100%. However, when you think about, and we went through all this logic, but when you think about the atmosphere on the station, if you're worried about the oxygen content or the CO2 level, none of that is going to change in an instant. I mean, it takes a while for CO2 to build up. It takes a while for the oxygen to go down. And as long as the equipment that takes care of that is working properly and you do a periodic check to make sure that the numbers you're getting match with the oxygen production or match with the ventilation effect through the CO2 removal, then you can be pretty confident that unless you have a failure in some system that's supposed to take care of that, that you're okay. Other areas that you would worry about if you had if you were working with an experiment and you had toxic materials, then you would take extra precautions to make sure that you didn't have spills and if something went wrong. If you couldn't measure it immediately, then you would go the extra mile to make sure that you were protected from that. So we have ways to mitigate that, as we call it, or to manage the risk. And as long as people are aware of it, then you take slightly more precautions, but you're in a very safe situation, as safe as you can be going 18,000 miles in a vacuum.
Rooster, do you want to add anything to that?
Well, I agree with Frank. The systems that maintain your atmosphere are designed and tested to function properly, so they do maintain your atmosphere. And all we're talking about here is our ability to understand what the atmosphere is, not our ability to maintain the atmosphere.
Good. Well, here's another one for you, Peggy. How are the results of the medical experiments shared and incorporated with the medical community on Earth? Share some of the results or impacts with us.
Okay, well, we actually have a database where all life sciences data goes into a database. The other types of research also have mechanisms. Because it's all government funded, we're required to allow that out to the public. And it's all available if the people have the desire to dig through all the information. That's probably the hard part of the job. But I think, you know, our primary objective on the space station scientifically is to understand, you know, how being in zero gravity affects our bodies and actually coming up with mechanisms and methods to minimize the negative effects on our bodies so that we can go to Mars at some point in time and be able to function when we get there. One of the biggest concerns in the past has been bone loss. And typically we lose bone in space at about 0.1% per month, which could be substantial over a period of time. We've seen localized losses even greater than that, up to 20% losses in the hip over 6 months, which is pretty dramatic. It would be considered clinically significant if you, you know, you could potentially break a hip, and obviously you wouldn't want to be breaking a hip on Mars. So we've always had very big concerns about that, and what's really interesting and very promising even already in the results that we're getting back is that we are doing some of the right exercises to protect the bone. The resistive exercise device that Frank talked about, we think, is really helping us out. I came back with no overall bone density loss, so I think we're definitely on the right track. We need to determine exactly for, you know, your average individual, which is considerable variation, we need to figure out what's the minimum required to maintain their bone mass over a long period of time. So I definitely think we're getting very promising results, and I think that going to Mars is not now any more limited by bone loss. I think we will be able to overcome that issue and develop exercise protocols that will work for everybody. So I'm really happy about those results. We still have other issues that we're going to have to look at for going long duration away from low Earth orbit, radiation being the biggest concern for us. I think we are protected in the, even in the space station, we're exposed to higher levels of radiation than we are here on Earth, but we're still protected by the magnetosphere of the Earth. And when we leave that magnetosphere, even the folks that left to go to the moon were exposed to much higher levels of radiation. If we're going to go to Mars, we're going to be exposed to much higher levels of radiation. We need to come up with mechanisms and ways to fix that in the future as well. And I think our research on board the space station will get us there. Research is never something even here on the ground that we can always predict what the outcome will be or that we in 2 weeks will have an answer to a question. I wish it were that easy. But it is always interesting what we come out with, and some of the most interesting research is answering the question, I wonder why that happened. So I think we've done a lot of neat things, everything, you know, from polarized sunglasses to artificial hearts that we've contributed to along the way, and you know, I hope that with continued exploration, I know that we'll be forced into developing the technology and the science that we'll be able to use back here on Earth as well.
Can we see any of the effects of zero gravity on the human body correlating to problems here on Earth?
Well, the osteoporosis effects that we see in elderly is very similar to the bone loss that we see in zero gravity, and we may be able to do some research to better understand that bone loss process in space. It happens to be it's caused by the different types of cells in the bone that are actually forming the bone versus tearing it down. And in space, the formation part doesn't happen, but the tearing down process is occurring. And so we can use some of those corollaries to help us understand some of the problems here on Earth as well.
Frank, you mentioned some medical experiments.
I'm a test pilot, George. actually, learning about the science and having the opportunity to take part in it is one of the really interesting parts of coming from the military aviation world and into NASA, because we get exposed to smart people like Peggy and in fact, Peggy was a principal investigator on one of the experiments that we had on my mission. I didn't show you any pictures of it because it was mainly just collecting urine. But what'd y'all do with all that stuff? anyway, and her experiment is designed to look at the formation of kidney stones and preventing that in space, because that's an issue also in addition to the bone loss. I think some amazing things have come out of space over the years. We haven't had the Nobel Prize winning or the Eureka that you might hope that would say, gosh, we got to go to space every day because we might come up with something like that. But we have had a lot of significant things that have been continued down here on Earth after being looked at in space, as well as there's some very promising technologies and some particularly life science experiments that are ongoing on the station. I believe someday we will have something that surprises everybody that comes out of what we're doing in the space station or the space shuttle or maybe on the moon or Mars. And people will say, wow, it, no matter what it cost, it was all worth it. And I think that day will come, and we'll all be glad that we've been going into space. The other thing that it does, the research that we have going on, I believe, is it encourages people down here to get more involved in technology and research, to get degrees in science and math and engineering. And we have seen, particularly during Apollo, that as the spending on NASA went up, the number of graduates in technical fields went up in this country. Part of that might have been due to the aerospace industry building up in response to that too, but I think there was also a correlation in how you motivated the people who were going through the universities as to what the future was all about. And I've found that people who are exposed to the space program tend to get more involved in those areas and continue to push it. And I think that we're setting an example and giving people a reason to get degrees in those areas, and that is the key to this country continuing to be the technology leader in the world, or in some cases regaining our lead in certain areas, because without the technology that has built this country, we're not going to maintain that leadership. We'll end up being a service industry.
Thank you. He's gonna answer the next. Before Brewster entered the military, he went to school at the University of Wisconsin and received his bachelor's and master's degree in engineering at Wisconsin. But also, while he was there, he led his own band. And this next question might be appropriate for you, Brewster.
Okay, George.
Do things like music sound different in space?
Say what?
Do things like music sound different in space?
No. At least not inside. There are some differences, though. Your taste changes, and I think that's partially due to the fluid shift that occurs in your body and whatever else. I'm not sure, Peggy, you might know. Your taste changes, your eyesight changes because your eyeball changes shape with the fluid shift. Things like that, but inside, I think sound is still the same.
Okay, there's another question that goes with this one. What determines the duration of the time on International Space Station missions?
When the bus arrives to pick you up.
Yeah, for instance, during my mission, it was planned to be 4.5 months long, and it ended up being just over 6 months long. Twice during my stay on orbit, we grounded the shuttle fleet for two different reasons while they were examining and trying to understand and make sure that we were safe to go. So twice during that time period, the fleet was grounded, and so my mission was extended in part because of that.
Yeah, I think that again points out the advantage that we have and we have today by having a program where we utilize the Russian capability. Because certainly we still have access to and from station with the Soyuz spacecraft and with the Progress. And I think that is a real benefit to having that kind of partnership. The Russians, I think, in the discussions I've had with them, feel about 6 months is the longest they feel probably is they want to keep crews up. They, of course, have had experience with crews much longer than a year, but 6 months and... As both Frank and Peggy say, our durations to large respect are set by the shuttle going up and down. Will the space station return to a three-person crew as soon as the shuttle returns to service?
Yes.
Yeah.
Should.
We have.
And hopefully that'll be very soon.
Amen.
Do you believe that the full potential and ability of the space station will be realized by with the development of a new space vehicle.
Say that again, please.
Do you believe that the full potential and viability of the International Space Station were realized only with the development of a new vehicle? Brewster, you want to?
Well, the thing that will enable the space station to be all it can be is by having enough people on board to do all the things that a full crew can do. In order to have enough people on board, we have to provide the capability to get those people off should something catastrophic happen to the station. As unlikely as that may be. So there are two ways to solve that. Either you use something you have, which would be Soyuz, or you build something new, which would be perhaps orbital space plane, perhaps something else. An orbital space plane would fit the bill, at least the way it's conceived now, or is being thought of now. So the answer is, I think, yes in the second part. If we build an American vehicle that we can use as a crew rescue vehicle, then certainly we can have a full crew, or we could elect to provide two Soyuz on board, and that would allow us to have six people on board.
Well, it would seem, Brewster, you'd need the shuttle as well, because you can't complete this reconstruction without the shuttle to get the full potential.
That it's assumed the shuttle will be there. Right. Yes, absolutely.
Also, the shuttle provides a heavy lift capability. One of the most important parts of science investigations is being able to get your samples back. And not only do we take interesting science up, but we also bring those samples back down. And the Soyuz doesn't offer us much down mass capability, and the Progress is burning up. So we do need down mass capability as well.
And that's, again, where we have a real advantage with the shuttle. There were air circulation problems in question on the Mir. How did we solve those problems on the space station?
The music.
Hey, I don't recall a lot of air circulation problems on Mir. The air quality in the space station is great. I was really surprised by how good it was. And in fact, some of my payloads, you know, one of the things I had to do was clean off the little ventilation fans on there. Dust would eventually collect on them. So each week I would clean them off with gray tape to collect all the dust when I was cleaning off all the ventilation systems in the laboratory and the node as well. And interestingly, as soon as I moved those payloads into the shuttle, I'd have to clean them twice a day. So the air quality on the space station is very good, and you know, the air is just a lot cleaner there.
As far as ventilation, if you saw pictures of the Mir, you may have noticed that there's a lot of hoses running from various modules all over the station. And the reason for that was because they were trying to make sure they had adequate ventilation everywhere, and some of it was add-on type ventilation as they learned more about operating on an ever-growing station. On space station itself, that ventilation has been designed into the modules, both the Russian and the American. And not only is the air very clean, but it's also moving a lot, and you have plenty of good quality air to breathe. I never had any trouble with stagnation or anything like that.
How easily do you get disoriented on the space station?
Actually, that was one of the most interesting things to me. We had installed the MPLM is a module to the nadir side. Most of the station is in kind of two-dimensional. You're going forward and aft, and you got a couple of other things off to the side. But we installed this MPLM to the nadir side, and you go inside it, and all four sides look exactly the same. You'd be taking things out, and you would exit the hatch into the station and expecting to see one direction, and you're just like, where am I? And I asked Carl and Dan, who'd been up there for 6 months, I'm like, do you ever get used to this? And is the direction of your head always up, you know, in your mind? And they said they thought it was still always up, but you get a lot faster at recognizing where you are. So you compensate for it in other ways.
Okay, here's another question related to the shuttle and station. Does the toilet on the station work better than the one on the shuttle?
Most of the time. People always ask, you know, how do you go to the bathroom in space? And I just say very carefully. Lots of airflow helps.
Are there any plans to expand the partnership in space with countries like Australia, China, India, South Africa, and the Middle East?
I don't know of any current plans, but I don't think we're opposed to that.
Well, I believe one of the criteria for participating in the space station, for example, is being able to contribute hardware or operations or experiments or some component to the station. And so a country would need to have a fairly well-developed aerospace industry and something to contribute that would justify them being participants. And I don't think anybody has approached us lately. Have you heard anything?
Well,
Chinese or the other non-participant that might be a
Brazil. Candidate. Brazil was endeavoring to become part of the space station partnership and providing some external mounting equipment for payloads outside, and they've had some economic problems in the country, so that's kind of slowed down. South Korea has approached NASA with some interest in participating in the International Space Station as well. Those are two that I know of.
What recent development or potential project excites you all the most?
I mentioned Franklin Chang-Diaz and his engine. I think that is really exciting, the development of new types of engines that will definitely get us somewhere farther into our solar system much quicker is really important. For instance, I mentioned earlier one of our issues is radiation. Well, if you can cut the travel time from 1 year down to 3 months, that would really decreases the risk associated with that as well. So I think Franklin's engines are really exciting, and other engine developments similar to his that are going on, really exciting.
Right,
another one is through JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California. NASA has a project undergoing called Prometheus, and specifically Jupiter Icy Moons Orbiter is the particular project that they're pursuing right now, which would put a nuclear fission reactor on a spacecraft, which would provide many, many times more power to not only the spacecraft engines, if you had electronic propulsion, which it will, but also when you arrive at the icy moons of Jupiter, you can provide 50,000 watts of power to the experimental equipment, as opposed to a couple of hundred watts that they are able to generate with solar arrays and small thermal ISO generators that they currently use. So if that's a successful project and we learn how to operate safely a nuclear reactor in that environment, and we can develop the electronic ion propulsion systems that allow you to accelerate halfway there, then turn around and decelerate the rest of the way, which cuts the travel time down markedly, then perhaps those systems can be applied to human spaceflight in the future if we can figure out how to make it safe enough to do so. And that would be very advantageous for trips to faraway places like Mars.
Well, I agree that those are really neat projects that I'm interested in seeing how successful they are, too. I think they have a lot of potential. But in the shorter term, possibly, the orbital space plane that's being developed now and will be competed fairly soon gives us an additional spacecraft. It'll start out probably, as Brewster said, as a rescue vehicle or escape vehicle, but it may eventually evolve into something that will give us an additional launch vehicle, an additional way to get into space. And I believe that more alternatives to access to space will help spur interest and help other projects that might follow. and other nations that might want to participate to get into space.
What are the top concerns for human beings working in space and their negative effects on the part of the astronauts? You answered that to a degree already, Peggy,
I think. Yeah, I think, you know, radiation obviously is a concern. Bone loss, as Frank added on, not only because of the actual osteoporotic effects on the bone, but because of that increased loss in bone mass, we're actually at a greater risk of forming kidney stones, which if those stones start moving while you're on orbit, it's going to be pretty excruciating, and you'll have to abort a mission, which would be very expensive. So that's part of why we do this research, to try and minimize the negative effects that might occur like that. We also have some cardiovascular deconditioning and musculoskeletal strength deconditioning. But we were actually, again, the exercise programs and the hardware that we've developed are really improving our capabilities in that arena, and we haven't been seeing the losses that we've seen before, and we think we're headed in the right direction. Hopefully, with enough subject number, we can convince ourselves that we do have exercise programs that will protect anybody on a really long-duration mission.
Okay. Going beyond the space station and the orbital space plane, what technologies are NASA and the international partners working on to improve our ability to go further in space?
I think we covered them already.
Hmm?
I don't know of any others than what we've already talked about. Do you, Brewster?
Well, Franklin's engine, I think you've touched on.
So. Peggy mentioned that.
And the, Prometheus.
Here's an interesting question. In budget, is the International Space Station really worth $100 billion? And could that money have been spent better on space exploration?
That is space exploration.
And I definitely think it's worth every cent. It's, you know, less than 1 cent of every taxpayer's tax dollar goes to the exploration of space. And as Frank pointed out before, you know, space really is our future. It's the future of our children. It's the inspiration for our children. And any country in the history of our world who's ever stopped exploration has pretty much stagnated. And I, for one, am not quite ready for us to just stop.
There are also some more mundane reasons. For example, in our country, or in our company, we have 10,000 employees, about 4,000 here in Texas, 6,000 in Florida. And the economic impact of those employees on the local economy is significant. The $100 billion, or however many it turns out to be, that it costs us to execute the space station program, the vast majority of that money is spent in the United States of America on jobs for Americans. So it has a positive impact on our economy, a positive impact on our country. It promotes the development of science and technology. It incites our children to be well-educated. There are a lot of positive benefits that come out of spending a few taxpayer dollars on the space program.
Well, very good. I think that's quite true. The money we spent on the lunar program wasn't spent on the moon. It was spent right here on Earth. As I mentioned, tonight was really looking at the present state of the space program, and Shuttle and the space station play a large part of that. And tomorrow evening we have a six-member panel that is going to be looking at the future of what we want to do in space and where we want to go. And Neil Lane will be moderating that panel. But as a preview, we have a question here that maybe we'll lead right into that discussion tomorrow night. What do you each of you believe should be the next step for NASA after space station?
Speaking off the record, right?
Right. Well, you and Brewster aren't with NASA. Peggy's the only one who's with NASA.
Yeah, but we're both contractors to NASA.
I'm going to wait and let the president tell us.
You all want to comment on that?
Well, I already gave you my opinion, and it's my personal opinion that I've had for a long time, and that's obviously we ought to continue building the station and continue to operate better and better there. But I believe the next goal ought to be to get back to the moon and build stations there. A lot of this technology that we have on the space station is applicable to work on the moon, and I believe we could transfer that there. It's a challenge. It's a huge challenge to get back there because many of you have seen the Saturn V lying on its side at Johnson Space Center. That was a terrific technological achievement that was stopped and put on display, and we'd have to reinvent something similar to that. But I think it can be done, and I think that learning to operate on a planet in our own backyard that's only 3 days away rather than 3 to 9 months away is the way to learn how to continue to explore space in a methodical and productive way. I just really think we need to be doing that, and I think that that would also continue to inspire people in an even more dramatic way than what we're doing now.
Yeah, I mentioned in the beginning that it had been 35 years since we had gone out of Earth orbit. We stopped doing that 31 years ago. That was our last flight with humans out of Earth orbit. And we have been focused on Earth orbit, and that's what we've been working on since that time. The space shuttle was first flown in 1981, which is 22 years ago now. And the space station got started in 1984, which is 19 years ago. And we aren't completed with the space station yet. We're still building the space station. So it has taken a long time to do. So I think we need to look to the future and where we're going. And we have, I think, lessons to be learned in the past from Apollo. President Kennedy announced we were going to go to the moon in 1961. And in 1968, 7 years later, we sent humans to the moon. As I say, the shuttle got started initially in 1972, and then it flew 9 years later in 1981. Space station got started in 1984, and we first flew humans onto the space station not very long ago. So I think we have shown that we can do things relatively quickly, and that there are real benefits to be gained when we take on a challenge. And so I think we have to look to the future and where we're going, because I think certainly the space program has provided inspiration for our young people. It's provided a lot of benefits to all of us here on Earth. We've been living off that technology and the benefits we gained from the Apollo program for many years. And so I think it's important now for all of us to look to where we're going, because the future is going to belong to the young and those generations that are coming beyond us. And so I think it's important for us to look at how we execute our stewardship and where we go. And fortunately, we had some people that I think had the vision in the 50s and the 60s that have allowed us to do what we're doing today. So I'd encourage all of you to come tomorrow evening so we can hear at least some of the opinions and people express some positions on what we ought to be doing in the future. And I thank you all for coming this evening, and I certainly thank our panel this evening, Brewster, Frank, and Peggy. I appreciate your coming and sharing your thoughts with us this evening. And we do have a reception immediately following the presentation, and it'll be done right out in the commons area. So again, thank you for coming, and thank you all for, I think, a very good evening.